Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Alka Khanna. I am an alumnus of Banaras Hindu University and a longtime resident of Washington, D.C. And it is my distinct pleasure to welcome all of you to the Embassy of India today for a very delightful evening and a talk which promises to be very special indeed. This evening is a collaboration between Banaras Hindu University Alumni Associations of USA, and together with the Embassy of India, we are presenting a talk by the Honorable Dr. Karan Singh, Honorable Member of Parliament and President of the Indian Council for Cultural Relations, ICCR, the topic being Mahamana, Madan, Mohan, Malaviya, his life's message. Before we begin, I have a small request. Please silence your cell phones so that there are no interruptions. And with that, I'd like to ask Ambassador Nirupama Rao to come and make her remarks.
Honorable Dr. Karan Singh and dear friends, this is a very special occasion. It is not every day that we have a personage of the eminence of Dr. Karan Singh to address us at the embassy. Dr. Karan Singh is no stranger to Washington. He spent almost a year here as Ambassador of India to the United States in 1989-1990. And even before that, when he was a young man of about 20, in his 20s.
17.
When he was 17, he spent a year here in New York and came to Washington, and in fact, as he was recounting to me yesterday, witnessed the inaugural parade of President Harry Truman. So it's a very, very long association with the United States, and he has seen a whole panorama of the history of this country unfold before his very eyes over these decades. Dr. Karan Singh is a Padma Vibhushan, and he has spent many years serving as a member of parliament in the Lok Sabha, and is now a member of the Rajya Sabha and president of the Indian Council for Cultural Relations. He is truly a Renaissance man because his accomplishments are wide and varied. He's a writer, a poet, an excellent raconteur, and his knowledge of Sanskrit and Indian philosophy is truly impressive, and I've been personally witness to that over the years. He's, as I mentioned earlier, now president of the Indian Council for Cultural Relations, and as you know, the Indian Council for Cultural Relations is the premier instrument in India for our cultural diplomacy and for the projection of India's soft power. That may sound cliched, the term soft power, for want of a better word, I'll use it, abroad. And he, I know, has been a tireless advocate of the promotion of India's culture across the world. And it is entirely due to his inspiration and his determination that today we are very close to sealing a deal on the purchase of a building for our cultural wing here in Washington. He's also very fond of music, not only the folk music of India, but the classical music of both the Hindustani school and the Carnatic school. And something you may not know, he's also a great fan of rock and roll. You know, he lists among his favorite singers Bill Haley and the Comets and many more. I'm sure he would give you more details if you asked him. So, sir, it's such a privilege to have you here and today to speak to us about the life and message of Mahamana Madan Mohan Malaviya. And I'll just add a certain personal note here. For many of us in the audience who know Rajan Devadas, you may know that he grew up in Banaras Hindu University, and from perhaps the 1920s, when he was a child, he had been going back and forth between Kerala and Banaras. His mother happened to be working at BHU. So he has literally sat at the feet of Mahamana Madan Mohan Malaviya. And today he sent me a couple of photographs which he had preserved from those days, which I'd be happy to show you later. And he recounted to me a great number of incidents from Malviyaji's life and his compassion and his great sense of understanding the importance that education and knowledge dissemination should be for India. And he was in many ways the harbinger of technical education, technological education and engineering studies to India, much, much before the Indian Institutes of Technology were set up. Banaras Hindu University was a shrine to providing the youth of India at a time when we had not won our independence, and this was 1916 that the university was established, that he enabled our young people to have access to the best of ideas from all over the world. He was never parochial. He stood for the globalization of education. To me, he seems to be a very modern man, even though he died before independence. But his lifespan, in fact, also encompassed much of our independence struggle. He was there at the first session of the Indian National Congress in the 1880s, and he died just a year before independence in 1946. So Mahatma Gandhi, Jawaharlal Nehru have all spoken so eloquently about Malaviyaji and his contribution. But I will not lengthen my speech further. Sir, we want to welcome you to the embassy, which you know so well. It's truly a privilege and honor to have you here today. And this is, as I said, a very important commemorative occasion also for a great Indian Pandit Madan Mohan Malaviya. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ambassador Rao, for your remarks. You've already had a rich introduction by the ambassador. The only thing I will add with your permission is that India celebrated the 150th birth anniversary of Madan Mohan Malviya. And this was inaugurated by the Prime Minister on the 25th of December, 2011.
That's what I was going to say.
I won't steal your thunder any longer.
Leave the rest to me.
Dr. Karan Singh.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you, Ambassador Nirupama Rao and all other friends in the audience. Many old friends I can recall. It's such a pleasure being back here. You know, I was here only for 7 months because I was a political appointee and Rajiv Gandhi lost the election, so I resigned. But nonetheless, those 7 months were really memorable for me. I have written them in a little book called Brief Sojourn. I have many records in my life, including Delhi University. I also have the record of having the shortest tenure of any ambassador to the United States. But it's good to be back here and in these surroundings. And I'm so glad, Ambassador, that you have organized this meeting here. I'd like to thank the ambassador, her team, also members of the BHU Alumni Association who are here, and if there's anybody from the Malaviya Mission, for having organized this function. As the young lady was going to say, and I'm sorry I interrupted her, on the 25th of December 2011, we began these celebrations. Before that, a National Celebrations Committee was set up with the Prime Minister as the chairman. And an implementation committee was set up under my chairmanship. And so on the 25th of December, at a very significant function in Vigyan Bhavan, the Prime Minister inaugurated these celebrations of 150th anniversary of Mahamana. There was a release of a postage stamp and several books and so on. And so for the whole of 2012, there were a large number of functions around the country, in many parts of the, particularly in North India, where he had such a major impact, was everywhere the BHU alumni became the focus or the nucleus of these celebrations. And we've also had some celebrations abroad. We had a function in Kathmandu. We had a function in London. And now, in a way, this function in Washington is sort of winding up, as it were, the observance of Mahamana's centenary. We had the closing function, I must tell you, on 25th of December 2012, with a special convocation of the Banaras Hindu University, where our president, President Pranab Kumar Mukherjee, delivered the convocation address, and the president of Nepal, Dr. Rambaran Yadav, I gave him, as in my capacity as chancellor, I gave him an honorary degree. So it was a unique function with presidents on either side of me, a real befitting tribute to Mahamana Madan Mohan Malviya. I do believe that his life is a message not only for India but for the world. And I can only pray to Lord Shiva, whose beautiful statue is there in front of me, that this message gets across for the welfare of India and for the world. Tejomayam saguna nirguna advitiyam anandakandam aparajitam aprameyam nagatmakam sakala nishkalam atma rupam varanasi purupatim bhaja vishwanath. In my prepared text, I have tried to encapsulate some of the important features of Mahamana's life. Every freedom movement around the world has produced outstanding leaders. But I think it would be safe to say that the sheer number, stature, and outstanding ability of the leaders of the Indian freedom movement are unique. If we leave aside for the moment the 1857 uprising, which we now call the First Indian War of Independence, and begin from the founding of the Indian National Congress in 1885, we will see a whole string of towering personalities representing various shades of ideology. The early stalwarts included Dadabhai Noroji, Firoz Shah Mehta, Gopal Krishna Gandhi, Gopal Krishna Gokhale, and M.G. Ranade as the moderate wing of the Congress then, and such charismatic personalities as Lokmanya, Bal Gangadhar Tilak, Sri Aurobindo, Lala Lajpat Rai, and Bipin Chandra Pal as leaders of the radical wing. This was in the early period. And then when the Banga Bhanga took place in 1905, when Lord Curzon partitioned Bengal against the wishes of the people, there was a massive upsurge of nationalistic fervor. And that was, in a way, the time when the freedom movement moved out of the drawing rooms and conference rooms into the masses, into the streets. And that really began the as it were, mass movement in India. And of course, when Gandhiji came into the picture, he was not only outstanding himself, but he gathered around himself many outstanding figures, such as Jawaharlal Nehru, Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel, Dr. Rajendra Prasad, C. Rajagopalachari, and many others. All these are well known to history. But there is one outstanding name that seems to have been largely neglected by historians, and that is Pandit Madan Mohan Malviya. I do not think that history has really done justice to him. And that is one of the reasons why we thought that these celebrations were an opportunity to reassess and rediscover the work of Madan Mohan Malviya. Malviji was indeed a many-faceted and multi-talented person. He was a social reformer. He was, although he was a devout Hindu, he was very clear that all this nonsense of untouchability and not allowing the Harijans or the Dalits to go into the temples and all was against the spirit of Hinduism. And he was therefore a social reformer. He threw his weight behind the social reform movements that had begun earlier. He was a powerful writer. He wrote extraordinarily well, both in English and in Hindi, and a riveting orator. English, Hindi, and Sanskrit, three languages he mastered. He was a leading lawyer, as many of the freedom movement leaders were, and an outstanding political leader, having been elected president of the Indian National Congress on four different occasions. People don't realize that. People don't know that Malaviya was Congress president on 4 different occasions. And he was a visionary intellectual and an educationist. Just because he was a devout Hindu, it seems that our generally left-oriented and liberal historians have tended to overlook his remarkable achievements. In fact, Malaviya was a strong proponent of social reform, worked tirelessly for the reduction of caste barriers in temples, and was in the forefront of the movement for Dalit entry into Hindu temples, Hindu shrines. He was one of the first leaders to announce, and I quote, "India belongs to the Hindus, the Mohammedans, the Sikhs, the Parsis, and others. No single community can rule over the rest." It was in this spirit that he opposed the communal award, and the Congress finally accepted his point. You may recall that the British had put forward a proposition of a communal-based electorate, which the Congress finally rejected. A more holistic approach to his life should place him in a historical perspective and not rush to easy, if misleading, conclusions. Malaviya was associated with the Indian National Congress for 60 years, from its inception in 1886 right up to 1946. Despite differences of approach, Gandhiji held Malaviya in high esteem. As the ambassador mentioned, Gandhiji wrote at one place, and I quote, "The name of Malaviya is magical for the people. Since I arrived in India," soon after he came back from South Africa, "since I arrived in India, I have had an intimate contact with him. I have lots of interaction with him, and I have known him very well. His views for this society are full of compassion and love. We love each other more than real brothers. I do not consider anyone a greater patriot than Malaviya. I always worship him. I do not see anyone among the present Indians who serves the country better than him." Now, here is a tribute coming from Mahatma Gandhi himself. Such glowing tributes from the father of the nation make it very clear that Malaviya was a major and influential figure in the freedom movement. It is not possible here for me to detail his many achievements. His role with Annie Besant and Pandit Motilal Nehru in the Home Rule movement is also a somewhat forgotten chapter in our freedom struggle. Although not in the mainstream of Congress politics, nevertheless was a significant factor in defining the contours of our freedom movement. It is often forgotten how the Home Rule League brought into public life early on one of India's finest sons, Jawaharlal Nehru. It was that Annie Besant also was a most remarkable woman, as you know. She was an Irish woman who played a major role in the Indian freedom movement. And she and Malaviya, and she helped, in fact, her Hindu school in Banaras became the nucleus of what was later to become the Banaras Hindu University. Basically, his political ideology was moderate. He continued to believe in his initial views that he had formed in the first 3 decades of his political career. That is why he participated enthusiastically in state and central elections, gave long speeches, and tried to influence the British government. You know, there was a view which Gandhi led that we should boycott all these institutions. Malaviya didn't agree with him. Malaviya said that we must use these institutions to raise our voice against the unjust rule of the British. When the national movement changed its form in the Gandhian era, he did not hesitate to work accordingly. He was fully committed to the civil disobedience movement. By the end of the Dandi March, he left the Indian Legislative Assembly and tried his best to make the movement a success, and in its first phase also went to jail. After Gandhi-Irwin Pact, he went to London to take part in the Round Table Conference. Sir Tej Bahadur Sapru, a distinguished publicman and lawyer, in his memoirs writes, and I quote, "No other Indian in the conference commanded as much respect from British politicians as he. In the second phase of the movement, he played an active role to guide the mass struggle." And therefore, I think it's very important for us to realize that Malaviya did play a very significant role in giving a certain direction to the freedom movement. Born in fairly humble circumstances in Allahabad on Christmas Day in 1861, he was a very bright student in the government high school, but was unable to study for the MA examination due to lack of resources. He was not coming from a rich family, and began to start earning as a high school teacher at a salary of 40 rupees a month. As a result of his brilliance and indefatigable energy, he rose to play an outstanding role in several fields, including politics, social reform, law, journalism, and education. He was an outstanding orator with an equal command over Hindi, English, and Sanskrit. His crowning achievement, however, was the founding of the great Banaras Hindu University at Varanasi in 1916. And we are going to celebrate the centenary of this in just 3 years from now. This was the first national university to be created in India. The British did set up universities in Mumbai, in Calcutta, in Chennai, in Delhi, but they were set up by the British. This was the first university set up by Indian scholars, with Indian initiative and with Indian funding. Almost single-handedly, he raised resources to build the great campus, which still remains one of the finest in the country. I don't know how many of you have visited it, but it is a remarkable campus and stands as a permanent monument to the remarkable vision, patriotism, and dynamism of Mahamana Malaviya. 4 years ago, I had taken President, 3 years ago, President Pranab Mukherjee to Banaras, and for the first time we went from the Varanasi airport to the university in a helicopter. And that was the first time that I saw the university from the air. I mean, I'd been associated with it for 40 years, 50 years, but I'd never seen it from the air. And seeing it from the air, one is astounded at the vision of this man. It's like a great Chandra, you know, like the great arc of the Ganga, or like the moon that Lord Shiva wears on his forehead. And it's laid out impeccably. And we have kept to the same architecture and developed it. It is difficult to conceive of anyone else who could have brought together on one platform the traditional literati, the new intelligentsia, with the princes, landowners, and businessmen in this august enterprise. He got everybody involved. He said, I'm prepared to be a beggar for the BHU. He went with a jhola, literally, and said, I've come as a beggar. He went to princes, he went to intellectuals, he went to businessmen, and single-handedly, he was able to collect enough money to build this university. He was himself the first vice-chancellor of the university from 1916 to 1946, till he passed away. And then he was succeeded by Dr. Radhakrishnan, whom he had selected earlier. So you can see the sort of level, the standard that he sought to bring to the university. His life's work, particularly the founding of the Banaras Hindu University, which will celebrate its centenary in 2016, will be long remembered by his grateful countrymen and tens of thousands of students who pass through its portals. There are many here. Wherever I go, I meet people who have been to BHU. Wherever in the world I go, they are scattered around the world and they are proud to belong to the BHU. Malaviji sought to combine ancient wisdom with modern technology. That's very important. In the Upanishads, you know, there's the concept of the paravidya and the aparavidya, the higher knowledge and the lower knowledge. In other words, the knowledge of worldly things, of all the sciences and all the arts, and the higher knowledge of spiritual striving. And he tried to combine both, paravidya, aparavidya, in this university. And that's why he called it Sarva Vidya Ki Rajdhani. It is a capital of all knowledge. The BHU Engineering College, which has now become the IIT BHU Varanasi, was one of the finest in India. He was not as you might have thought, a sort of idealist who said, no, nothing to do with technology and science. He in that way, in some ways, he was even more modern than Gandhiji. Gandhiji was very much involved in Khadi and Charkhar, which is very important. But Gandhiji didn't start an engineering college. Malviji did start an engineering college because he realized that the India that was growing, the India that was emerging, would sooner or later need the technology of the West if it is really going to make a breakthrough. And that, of course, is what Jawaharlal Nehru also felt very strongly. In his own words, Malviji's words, I quote, "A university should preserve the noblest traditions of the past and, breaking away from there, where necessary, adapt itself to the requirements of the present and of the future." I think this is an excellent definition of what a university should do. It must be rooted in the past, because if we forget our past, then we lose our roots. And the sort of rootlessness that one sees around the world nowadays is because people have lost their spiritual roots. But we have to break away from old modes of functioning. We must break away from anything that smacks of superstition and revanchism and revivalism and move boldly onto the future. And our philosophy, particularly the Upanishads, give us that very clear message of spiritual striving, cutting across all barriers of race and religion and sex and any other. So the Malviji's vision of a university that would combine the traditional with the modern, the engineering university with the Sanskrit Mahavidyalaya. So Banaras became, BHU became a center for Vedic and Upanishadic studies, also became a center for medicine and for engineering. I have had the honor of being chancellor of the Banaras Hindu University for over a decade, from 1960 to 1966, if you please. I was a young man. And then with a 40-year gap from 2006 to the present day. So I seem to have some kind of a spiritual... I'm a worshipper of Lord Shiva. And Varanasi, of course, is the city par excellence of Shiva. And so it's been a great... it's a great privilege to be associated with this university. I was also chancellor of JNU and JNK University and others. But this is very special, because Banaras University is a very special university. And I've been overwhelmed by Malviji's vision of having created, almost a century ago, a magnificent campus combining humanities and technology. Most important of all, Malviji stood for certain moral and spiritual values, which, and unfortunately, are conspicuous by their absence in our current scene, particularly ethics in public life. The epitome of simple living and high thinking, Malviyaji with his white turban became a symbol of an alternative lifestyle which was neither ascetic nor hedonistic, but was based firmly upon our ancient cultural heritage, particularly the Upanishads. Maybe I should say a few words about the Upanishads. As I see them, they encapsulate universal values. Ekam sat vipraha bahudha vadanti. The truth is one, the wise call it by many names. This is the basis of the interfaith movement in which I have been involved for 40 years. And that interfaith movement seeks to bring together people of different religions in a harmonious dialogue. It's not a shastra-arth to prove the superiority of one religion over the other, but it is really a cooperative endeavor to bring together people of different religious communities. And this began in 1893, another very significant year, where the first Parliament of the World Religions was held in Chicago, where Swami Vivekananda, whose 150th anniversary also we are celebrating from this year onwards, made such an impact. So the whole interfaith movement can be encapsulated in the three words, Ekam Sat Vipraha Bhaudha Vadanti. Then the concept of the world as a family. If you go to Parliament, I'm not going to say what goes on within Parliament. I mean, I'm going to leave unsaid. But if you go to the Parliament building and you go to the first gate into the central hall, there's a beautiful shloka. Ayam nija paro veti gananam lagu chetasam udar charitanam tu Vasudeva Kutumbakam. This is mine, that is yours, is a narrow and an uninspired way of looking at things. For those of the higher consciousness, Udhar Charita Namtu Vasudha Eva Kutumbakam. The world itself is a family. What other motto can they be for the global society but these three words? In the same way as Ekam Sat Vipra Bahudha Vadanti is the basis of the interfaith movement, Vasudha Eva Kutumbakam is the basis of the globalization that we are seeing. We are seeing a technological globalization in front of our very eyes, in our very lifetimes. I can remember a time, believe it or not, when there wasn't any television. If you tell a youngster now that the human race existed for thousands of years without television, they won't believe you. But the fact of the matter is that they did. And all this has taken place in our lifetimes, with television and the internet and the World Wide Web and Twitter and all sorts of weird and strange experiences that you can have. I'm a pre-computer generation, but I was given, if you please, on my 80th birthday, 2 years ago, I was given for the first time an iPad. And so now I play Scrabble, I play Bridge, and I play chess with the eye. I don't know how to use all the other gimmicks, but this at least I take part of. So this idea of the world as a family, Vasudha, is a great idea. Mind you, not the world as a market necessarily. A market is essentially an sort of exploitative structure, whereas a family is a conserving structure. It's a structure that helps to support everyone, which is why in the emerging global society it is so important for us to move towards some kind of equity. You cannot have a family in which millions live on the verge of starvation and millions die of overeating. I mean, that's just not on. And therefore, we have to move toward that. It's a different topic. I'm not talking about that today. But I'm raising it now in the context of the Upanishadic thought, which is so tremendously important. There's another phrase, Nirupamaji. Bahujana sukhaya, bahujana hitaya cha. There's no better definition of socialism. Karl Marx has written a huge tome, and so many people have written on socialism. But bahujana hitaya, bahujana hitaya, the welfare of the many, the happiness of the many. What a beautiful definition it is. These are nuggets that we get from the Upanishads. And these are concepts that cut across all barriers, which is why all sorts of superstitions like untouchability and all are in fact a negation of our cultural heritage. How they came in, why they developed, I'm not going to go into that controversy. But the fact is we have now got to shed all these undesirable growths, and we've got to go to the heart once again of our spiritual tradition. And that heart, I believe, lies in the Upanishads and lies in the concepts of the Upanishads, which are global concepts, which are not concepts for any particular race or any creed. The Upanishads call the human race Amritasya Putraha, children of immortality. What a beautiful idea. Each one of us encapsulates a spark of the divine. And fanning that spark into the blazing fire of spiritual realization is the greatest goal of human life. That is what our rishis believed. And so these great concepts, we seem to have lost them. We should certainly do whatever we can do it with technology and science. I have nothing against it at all. Except that one day we're going to blow ourselves up, but that's a different matter. that reminds me of a rather amusing story. There was a cosmologist who was giving a lecture. And he said that, in the course of the lecture, he said that the world had been in existence, the cosmos had been in existence for about 10 billion years and would probably last for another 10 billion. So at the end of the lecture, a frail old lady got up and said, "Sir, how long did you say the world will last?" He said, "Ma'am, I said 10 billion years." She said, "Oh, thank goodness, I thought you said 10 million years." So, as Lord Keynes said, in the long run, we are all dead. So the point is that whatever may be our immediate involvement, we've got to understand the basic power of these ideas. In the same way as Greek thought was the basis of Western civilization, Upanishadic thought was the basis of Eastern civilization, and now of global civilization. Because now the East-West divide, the North-South divide is no longer really rigid. Now there are countries like India that are rising, that are developing fast, and there are countries in Europe which were very affluent, which now seem to be going through a different period. So there are cycles in human history. But within all those cycles and within all the extraordinary developments that we see around us, we've got to hold firm to the inner conviction that the sort of ideals that Malaviyaji stood for are eternal. Although he passed away in 1946, just before independence, his memory and his work will continue to be honored for generations to come. His 150th birth anniversary was a good occasion for us to rediscover and reassess his contribution to the development of India's cultural profile. And he will always be remembered with gratitude. Thank you very much. If there are any questions, I brought some copies of a DVD, Ambassador, on Malaviyaji. I've got about 10 or 12 copies, so if you would like, whatever you would like to do with them. I'm also vain enough to have brought a copy of my own DVD about me. This is an interview with me called I Believe. It's only me, it's not an interview. It is me talking. It's me talking about religion, about philosophy, about love, about death, about politics, about the environment, or you name it. So here it is. If anybody wants to see it, in the unlikely event of anybody wanting to see it, I'm going to leave a copy. She'll have to arrange a showing. Yes, ma'am. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you.